Good morning, Peaches.
Good morning.
Thanks for joining us for this artist conversation.
Thank you.
Danke fürs Kommen, danke fürs Aufstehen, danke fürs Durchmachen. Mein Name ist Natalie Brunner.
Hello.
I'm a radio DJ. And
yes, FM4, what a great station. It's special. You don't have this kind of attention to actual connecting local and global, you know, roots and kind of music, you know?
I remember the first time I saw you, it was on a hallway in the old Funkhaus in Vienna, and you were there with Gonzalez. Uh-huh. I think he was playing Flex, and it
was the
Safari Suit show.
Uh-huh. No, it had to be before the Safari, because Feist used to play the Safari show with him.
Was it before?
Yeah, it was before
the Teachers of Peaches were released?
Yes, yes. So I came here and was visiting. I mean, Gonzalez and I came here and visited before that, like 1998, where we were just playing electronic music with no vocals or anything. And we went around and told people, we can take our machines and plug them into your stereo system, you know, because it was 1998, you didn't have a laptop, and people were like, oh, and it'll come out of the speakers, and then we have live, like, electronic music in the club, ooh, you know, like on this
with
level.
With voices and people.
No, no, we didn't have voices. Okay. We were just like, yeah.
Before we go to the Teachers of Peaches, I think I have to express a great personal thanks for last night.
Okay.
I think the last 2 years were a bit traumatizing for me, probably for everyone, in relation to how we deal with our bodies, how we deal with other people's bodies, how we deal with bodily fluids. And having you ejaculate from a giant penis on me, on us, I think that's a moment I'm going to cherish for a long time. And when I was walking out of the concert, everybody was so happy. Everybody was so energized, and everybody felt so liberated in a way. And so actually, I wanted to ask you, was it for you as good as it was for me?
It was good for me. It was good for me. I'm going to tell you that I've been pleasantly surprised by everywhere I've gone. I'm not trying to say you're not special, Graz, but I've been pleasantly surprised by the reaction. It isn't a concert. It's definitely, and I'm not trying to sound, if I sound narcissistic and you want to call me out and you want to go like, you're delusional, just raise your hand. I won't see it. I'm really surprised in a beautiful way of just like the openness right now. I think it's more of a moment than a concert because people are like reflecting on the, you know, the last 2 years. People are reflecting on the last 20 years. People are reflecting on themselves of where I've come from. I think something about the Teachers of Peaches album, and particularly obviously Fuck the Pain Away, is a sort of like, for a lot of people, this like coming of age moment that doesn't matter if you're a teenager, but this that moment where you're like, I can fucking be whoever I need to be. I don't have to, you know? It's just this like, boom, boom,
it's
I've arrived.
It's a mantra that holds up for eternity.
Yeah, and it's like, I've arrived. And what is really interesting, and I'll just go on and on because what's really interesting is the song was actually recorded live. I was trying out the song. I had some ideas. I had Fuck the Pain Away. I had Sucking on My Titties Like You Wanted Me. I wanted to reference Chrissy Hynde and Blondie because they were both successful, strong artists that made it after 30, and I was 33 at the time. So I was trying out this song in a club. There were like 10 people, but the sound woman, she recorded it on a cassette tape. And after the show, she said, hey, Peaches, I made a a cassette tape, and if you give me $5 Canadian, you know, then you have it for reference or whatever. And I was like, cool, cool. So I took the tape and I listened to Fuck the Pain Away, and I was like, this sounds cute, I'm gonna put it on a demo and then ask people what they think, because I was thinking about maybe getting a producer, or like, I was like, maybe I should produce on my own, I've never produced, blah, blah, blah. And I would play it for people, for like party people, for friends, blah, blah, blah. And nobody was saying like, oh yeah, I feel like it's missing, you know, like a kick, or it's missing this, or lyrically, or about the song structure, nothing. Everybody said, this is cool. And I was like, it ain't broke, don't fix. And I never recorded it again. And that's the version that you hear on the album, and that's the version that you've heard every time it's been used in any major or underground film or sync, which is obvious, which is of course like when it's used in a commercial or a TV show or anywhere.
One line from this song?
From the first time I've ever played it. And yeah, just because I used my Roland MC-505, and I was just like playing it. It was half programmed, and yeah.
One line that always surprises me.
Oh, sorry. One
is
line.
Stay in school because it's the best.
Right.
Are you quoting somebody? How did this line come into context of that lyric?
There was a lot of like in the 80s, you know, the Nancy Reagan like, don't do drugs, stay in school, these kind of lines. So it was just this sort of like putting into context of like, hey kids, this is what you need to do, you know? Because it was the teachers of peaches, so. So I was also saying stay in school, and then I was saying IUD, like use contraception methods.
Yesterday at the show, mm-hmm. I saw some very young disciples for the Teachers of Teachers.
Disciples, okay.
a young lady about 8 years old standing next to me.
Eight.
And
was she in the front?
No, she was on the balcony.
Oh, wow. Okay.
And I...
Was there parent supervision? Did they just rock up alone?
Yeah. And I said, actually, it makes complete sense, mm-hmm. because the sexual utopia, mm-hmm. you lead us to, mm-hmm. it's free of violence, mm-hmm. it's free of authority, mm-hmm. and it's free of the things that personally scare me when very successful rap artists, females, go on stage, because they always bring capitalism into the equation. They put their body on a stage as if it was a good, as if it was...
Well, I don't think that's fair. I don't think that's fair to say. I don't think the context is the same for you as is for the context of what's going on there. So
US or for...
For what you're saying about yeah. other artists, or how they, or the context of what, you know.
I think it's.
I don't think we can judge yeah. that.
And no, I don't want to judge it. I think it's just the word bitch is used so frequently.
I use bitch. I use get down there and lick, 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 bitch. Mm-hmm. I say bitch also. So let's agree to disagree on that,
okay.
and we can focus more on me.
No, but would you think that capitalism is something that stays out of your artistic conception?
I'm just saying, from my context, I want to always be in control. I want to create a community. I want people to be involved, but I definitely want to be the focus too. So I think that helps people to like find a point. I weigh in, but then they understand that it's not just me. It's like I'm a gateway. I'm like a gateway drug to like community in that situation.
When you did the album, mm-hmm. were you like collecting ideas, collecting songs, or was it a very conceptual approach? I'm gonna sit down when I walk out of the kitchen and
yeah.
write these 12 songs, and I'm
yes,
going
to
be very precise.
Exactly,
very
it was very precise. The machine, also very interesting, only allowed for like, I would say 16 sounds, and probably 8 of them are one track that's rhythm that you can like use as a sub track, mm-hmm. Like a hi-hat and a snare and a, I don't know if I'm dumbing it down in what way or who knows what, but hi-hat, snare, kick, tom, percussion of other kinds. And then you can use 8 different sounds any way you want, and then you can just like manipulate those sounds. I'm sure there's a lot more complicated ways you can use it, but I never wanted to learn. I wanted to give myself this restriction and this very directness, and in that the same way. Now I forget your question. I feel like I was on track, but what was your question?
Conceptual, if it was conceptual, yes, so that or was if the it was building.
Yeah, that's the that was the concept. Yeah, and because I wasn't, I was definitely, I mean, you're always collecting whatever you're listening to or whatever you're hearing in terms of like what people are saying or what conversations you're having at the time. That always is collecting information, you know, but I wasn't like calculated, if that's what you mean. But maybe a bit in conceptual because I wanted to, and at the time, you know, there was very a very purist idea of like, this is rock and roll, techno, you know, and then like experimental electronics. They weren't really together. There was like, you know, rock and roll, what I was interested in, it was the very repetitive riffs. But to me, it's actually quite the same as house music with very repetitive riffs. So I wanted to like make that connection to make it more rough. And I also was very interested performatively of not being that typical, I'm making some science lab music where I have to like mix up the medicine and can't look up to you because if I put this filter just a little bit too long, it'll change the alchemy, you know, things like that. So I want it to be like, boom, rah, you know, so like bring it all together. And that really confused people too.
What machine are we talking about?
The MC Roland Groovebox 505.
Did we see it yesterday on stage?
You did.
Next
you saw it rolling around like a R2-D2. Because it was like on wheels, remember, at the beginning. Was anybody at the show last night? Oh, that's great, great. Are there any Peaches virgins here? No, just kidding. Is this your first Peaches lecture? No, I'm just kidding. Oh, I'll put you through that.
The gentleman who was controlling the wristbands?
I'm sorry?
The gentleman at the door who was controlling the wristband, he was a Peaches virgin. And after, I think, 2 songs, he left his post to shake everything.
Aww,
you've got.
That was, I think,
also,
yeah,
very cute.
Yeah, I heard about that.
The was the album.
And this is, yeah, so fun for me, you know, like to see people just like transform during the show too, because I'm so excited. I work really hard to make a trajectory, you know, like I'm also conceptually, I'm very interested in being a director. I come from theater, you know, I wanted to always make cool musicals. I went to theater school and I was laughed at because I wanted to make cool musicals. People were like, we're doing Ibsen here, we're doing Three Sisters Chekhov, we're not doing musicals. But so I want to take my conceptual directorial ideas, and I always want to make surprises and arcs and you know, dips and highs.
I think I know no one but you who masters that art of amplifying rock poses,
yeah,
and amplifying the authority,
mm-hmm,
or the proclaimed authority a performer, uh-huh, has on stage, but then at the same time breaking it down completely because you walk on people like Jesus walks on water. And I think this
for those of you, she's saying that, she's not trying to do that disciple thing. I used to say a line every time, like, Jesus walks on water, Peaches walks on you.
I remember. So. No, but this is a very subtle, masterful dialectic of amplification and then tearing it down at, mm-hmm, the same time. And I think you're the master of it.
It's just really, I really want to connect with people. That's why, you know, when you talk about Corona in the last 2 years, it's very difficult because my practice is very physical, very in the moment, very there, right there, human feeling, reaction, you know, elation. I've had, on this tour, I've had people going like, I cried, I laughed, I danced, I couldn't move, you know.
I felt free. I walked out of the concert singing the Fist Me song.
That's the new name for It's All Coming Back to Me, the Fist Me song. Maybe I can plug that I do have a remix called Fist, though, that was put out this year with me, with Lee Bowery. Are you familiar with Lee Bowery? Shame on you all.
Yes, 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 I am.
You are, okay, thank you. No shame on you. Lee Bowery, so you can look up Lee Bowery and be amazed. So, they had very vulgar, incredible lyrics, and I made it into a duet, a techno song. So if you ever have a techno DJ set and you don't know what to do, you can always play my remix of Fist. Just a tip.
20 years back, mm-hmm. The album. Mm-hmm. Your move to Berlin.
Yes.
The album was finished?
Yes,
you finished it in Berlin?
No, I made the album in Toronto. So like I said, in 98, Gonzalez and I were going city to city, plugging in stereo systems. And we ended up in Berlin. We went to a small club called Gallery Berlin Tokyo, which was just filled with a lot of really cool artists and musicians who were very open. We said, can we do a gig? And they were like, yeah, on Thursday. So we came back on a Thursday, and a small label happened to be there, Kidio, like a tiny, tiny label. And after we did our just electronic set, they asked if we could play a festival, if we could come back in November and play a festival at Volksbühne, which was like, that never happens in Canada. It's like, oh, great, you played, now let's get back to music, you know, because they didn't know what to do. But so there was no, you know, like this inspiration, like, wow, this people are interested. And I had a job back in Canada. I took all the feelings that I had of the how I felt in Berlin and how I was feeling. I had a very, after a long-term breakup, I had thyroid cancer, where I had my thyroid taken out. I wasn't ever really physically affected by it, but it was, you know, it affected my brain, like saying, in terms of understanding mortality and saying, what do I want to do with the rest of my life? There was that moment, and I had this machine. I had no other musicians. Everybody had moved away. So it's just like, let's just make it, hunker down. And I wanted to make it in a way that didn't make me feel like I'm so sad about the breakup. Oh, I can't. None of that was mentioned. I was just like, what's the next, how to move on? And so I made it in Canada. So, and then I sent a demo over just for fun. And
when you to Berlin. Took the name Peaches, this was also a personal decision, an indicator for a personal transformation that happened.
Yes.
So you would not say you're in character when you perform. You transform maybe, but Peaches is you.
I like that. I like that you say I like that, because people are always like, where does Meryl begin, or where does Peaches begin and Meryl ends? I like that though. But definitely, Peaches is more of a performative, like exploration of Meryl.
The song like. Talk to Me. Mm-hmm. Is it a song where you also discuss that? Where
with myself?
Yeah. Where do I start? Well, because it's me, it's not a Peaches show, if I remember right, the lyrics.
Right, that was more like, this is an intimate moment. This isn't about Peaches show, this is about you and me. Yeah. But you know, everything you do write about someone else is obviously about you anyway, so.
I forgot what I wanted to ask. Yes, Kittyo.
Yeah.
Jeans Team.
Yes.
You played Keine Melodien.
Yeah.
I was happy to hear that.
Yeah.
Can you tell us what the mood was like in the Kittyo headquarters?
Well, even before Kittyo, actually, Jeans Team was one of the bands that and Honeysuckle, they were an art collective, and they were people from Jeans Team, and Honeysuckle kind of worked together, and they were all part of the gallery Berlin Tokyo. So they were like the first people I really connected with, along with Cobra Killer, and you know, to that created a little scene for us. And Gene's team was like, you know, like the boy band version of Peaches. They were really like, they had this idea, I remember, that I always thought was brilliant. Instead of like, you know, taking a drum kit and smashing it, that they just wanted to, throughout the show, piece by piece, just slowly take it apart.
Screwdriver.
Like, yeah. It's methodically, but and we toured together. We toured Finland together, just in a van. And they were releasing Kind of Melody, and then asked me and DJ. Oh, now I forget their name. I'm sorry, but asked me to make a remix. So instead, I kind of made a cover.
And how how does it fit into the context of the 20 years anniversary show?
Because it was a bonus track on my 20-year album. So, yeah, you know, at that time when you... I actually released the album in 2000 with Kiddio. And then in 2001, Sony came sniffing around and asked to do a single. And it was one person at Sony in the dance department that was interested. And of course, like major labels happen and everything, the minute he had this whole plan set up, they had moved him to a different department, and then somebody else came in to do the department. I don't, that always happened in major labels, especially at the end of the 90s, 2000s. And then that person obviously didn't give a fuck about me or what I was doing or anything. So they had all these channels of how to promote this, like a remix single, and make a video. And I was like, this is great, because we'll get the album out and everything. But what I didn't know is that they bury the album for 8 months. They bury the album while they work on the single. So I did it. That was my only time that I flirted with the major label. It was a horrible experience. I saw how also the PR worked quite different, because the PR I was doing with Kiddio was very organic. People wanted to talk to me. People wanted to, you know, they were excited about whatever PR they were doing. In this channel, it was just like, go through all the channels around Europe. And people were like, who is this? Peaches? Okay, all right, this is what I read on the sheet. These are the five questions. And you really felt the difference. So I really felt more like very isolated, very disconnected when I was doing those, you know. And also the representative felt very like, oh, he was just like, when's my next drink? When's Motorhead coming back to town? You know, that kind of feeling. But so that was a good awakening. And then XL Records, which was more independent at the time, part of Beggars Group, they wanted to sign me, and I was like, can we re-release the Teachers of Peaches album? Because it just didn't get a fair shake, because all these people were so interested, and all of a sudden then it was just buried. So wasn't really conventional, but then we re-released it. So then we released it with bonus tracks, and yeah.
How did you... No, let me ask this differently.
Yeah, that's what you should
stories, do. rumors that probably have some substances but never went to court about horrendous things that are happening in the context of the music industry and have happened for ages. And I always find myself asking why. Why can bands still go on tour, still play huge stadium shows and haven't had their Me Too Harvey Weinstein moment, although it's out there, it's on the internet, and the music industry still covers that up. How did you maneuver throughout your career through this world without being impacted by this horrendous shit that is going on?
Because I never really was part of that world, you know, I was never... obviously accepted because I'm, you know, for what I'm doing, I was not classically good looking. So I don't, you know, like in that way fit into that mold of it. I found out I was ugly from articles written about me. So I'm ugly, by the way.
Okay.
Okay, I just wanted to let you know I'm ugly.
Can't see
I read, okay. I read I'm ugly, so I'm ugly. No. It was fascinating to me on so many levels of what I did was controversial, because I was just saying things in a very direct way from my point of view, that in a way that I didn't hear. My point of view, you know, I didn't hear a queer point of view. I didn't hear a broad perspective. I heard a standard that was very set, which was, you know, like a lot of binary sets that we are used to, that we accept, that aren't, you know, that aren't real. They're real, but they're not true.
How the perception of bodies has changed through the digitalization. Mm-hmm. Did that have an impact of your world on your work, or do you take that into consideration, that the perception people have of themselves is influenced by Instagram filters? And how beauty standards have shifted more and more to a level that is unapproachable by human beings.
I think that it's all in the way that you use things, and they all get distilled down in a very dumbed down way sometimes. I love dumbed down, but not in a creative way, because there are such incredible tools that you can be so creative with, but people are still afraid, and it compounds the fear for some people. Like, I have to like cover everything, I have to be so perfect, and some people can really make a performance out of this, which can be beautiful. Like, I my ideal of myself, how I see myself, is this way, and I can feed into that, which is if it's natural and authentic for that person, that's great. You can also completely disintegrate your body, and you know, some people do not feel like body is part of their sort of reality, so in that way they can move through a digital sense. So it's all in the way people use it, you know, and there's a lot of incredible tools. So I don't want to just focus on the only little negative that is, again, very binary, mainstream. You want to remember that there's a way to queer it up. There's a way to be completely creative about it. There's a way, there's always a way. It's you're not restricted, like, ooh, Instagram has ruined our lives. There is a way, and we just, as everything, we have to take control ourselves.
Good time for questions from the audience.
Yeah, yeah. Questions?
Yes, no.
Questions, comments? Can you still hear my chain?
Yes.
You can?
So, first of all, thank you so much. It was incredible, the show yesterday.
Thank you.
Absolute highlight. I've come from Berlin, and this is just an icebreaker question about how you stay politically motivated and to keep sort of pushing for the things you're pushing for, seeing as our reproductive rights are shrinking and a lot of the spaces around us that gave home maybe to subculture are shrinking as well. In Berlin, the Tacheles, which is a place that I used to spend a lot of time in, I think you also did at some point in your life and careers, being turned into luxury apartments for millionaires, and it seems that the push is getting harder and harder. So how do you make sure that you and the community that you're building around you can stay politically motivated to keep pushing for those spaces not shrinking? although his right's not shrinking.
I'm gonna say something just in terms of like what Tacheles, the history of Tacheles, just to use it as an example. Do you know what the first thing Tacheles was? It was a Jewish department store. And then it was bombed, and then it became a prisoner of war camp, and then it became in the East a place of, you know, it's gone through many changes, and that's Berlin. Right? That's Berlin, and now it's high-end. That's what Berlin is. That's what's happening in Berlin right now. Gentrification is a scary, crazy, very fast elevating thing that's going on. I don't have the money to stop it or invest in, you know, but... to be honest, I have to take control of my own way. So I do have some money. So I've purchased a live work space, and I will make that what I will want to make it, you know, or we will want to make it, me and my partner together. Things are shrinking, and things are, you know, we just have to do our best. I don't have anything but a grim answer for you with that, but. I think people are really freaked out about Berlin right now, about changing attitudes and changing the focus on money. But I hear that Graz is a communist government right now, so maybe we can just come here.
More questions?
That was not a good answer. That was really just like placating, but I yeah.
Hi.
Hi.
Refreshing having seen your show, thanks. You're a cuckoo cat. Has there ever been a time where you weren't as sexually liberated as you are now, or at least appear on stage? Like, or...
Do you know how sexually liberated I am?
Tell me.
No. I'm just putting out there what I want to put out there, and it's definitely a development. I'm just talking performatively as Peaches. When I started, it was very much a struggle. You know, you look out into the audience and people are like, ooh, or pointing at my camel toe or hair coming out of my shorts, so like, or laughing at me, or like standing in the back but not leaving, like a car crash, like I'm not sure if I can leave, but I really want to watch this. So it's more, and me feeling more like I have to, like a fighter, like come on, you know. Sweating it out. And now, I would say 92% of the time, it's very much like, I feel more at peace with it, and I can feel people with me. So I'm not answering your question either, but that's all I'm gonna say.
But I think you're answering my question.
Okay, good.
I didn't
See,
ask.
I knew.
No, what you learned, personally from your performative practice.
I am, yeah. And also I'm learning also, I think going back to a question maybe I didn't answer again, just about like just shedding binary ideas and even understanding vocabulary and us all understanding the vocabulary and being open to it and shedding our own like what we're holding on to, but in a binary sense that we all do, that what we need to work on, you know, and I work on it too. I think when I first started, there was no language for me, or, you know, so I was just like, I feel like a man, I feel like a woman, you know, like, but I have this much men and this much, you know, now we have terms like spectrum or, you know, less of a shame or less of a, you know, it's more understood or accepted or at least it's out there.
But don't you think that the people, when Teachers of Peaches came out, immediately understood that there is a human being talking about sexuality that just belongs to itself. It's not about pleasing anyone.
Right.
It's not about fulfilling standards. It's not about power hegemony. It's just about me. And I think when young people, not me, listen to that, it was so liberating and empowering because, yes, I can do it. I can do what the fuck ever I want. The only person I have to please is myself. And to make that point is extremely fearless, because I think, at least in my life, Teachers of Peaches was the first album, the first music album, the first artwork where I encountered that statement in a language that is immediately understandable and feelable to everybody that hears it. So it was a pioneer masterpiece.
And I think that's important that you feel like, I want it to be as inclusive as possible, you know.
Even the gentleman checking the wristbands at the door got it in two songs and was...
And why not?
But was there in the creation of the Teachers of Peaches the element of fear that was fucked away or that was locked in noise, or were you always that fearless and precise? And
I'm not like fearless. I was just, I had a lot of questions.
Sorry?
Maybe not so fearless. I just had a lot of questions.
Okay.
So that was my way of presenting the questions, or like sharing what are the, let's look at these questions.
What?
Any questions?
Yeah, questions.
Yes.
Sorry. Hi, I mean, first praise you for yesterday.
Oh, thank you.
Thank you. And I wanted to ask regarding audience, what was the experience? Because I saw you when you opened the Marilyn Manson show.
So oh, you did?
Yes.
That was, we did it here, that's right. We did it in Austria, we did a show, that's
yeah,
right.
Yeah, I saw it in Paris, I think.
Oh, that was a hot...
It was in Vienna, I think, in Stadthalle as well.
But you saw the Paris one, because that, to me, was the most hardcore show I've ever done in my life.
But did you continue then the show with Marilyn Manson? I can't
remember. Yes, we did 6 weeks.
You pulled it through.
Yeah, that show, I lost my shit, because every night there would be these horrible, in my mind, horrible Manson fans that were, you know, dressed like so goth and so like we're alternative. But I would come on and all they'd do is go. And so in Paris, someone like horked a loogie at me. Do you know what that means? That you go like to get all the like phlegm, the really hard phlegm, and then spit it on me. So I remember this, like horky spit on my arm, and it stunk like their alcohol. And I was like almost puking, and I was like, that's it! And I went in the audience, I just started smashing people over the head with a microphone. I should have been arrested. But I was just like, fuck you, you fucking assholes, which is not their fault, it's my fault. But then I got the respect from the whole Manson crew, and after that night, they were like, we got your back. and I made the decision to like not let it get me, and I developed some really good one-liners, like, you think you're black sheep, but you're sheep in black. You know, or I'd be like, your God invited me here. Your God likes me. So, yeah. But those were very hardcore, but very, very early. This was 2003, 10,000 people who didn't want to see me. I came on stage and they'd be like, yay, because they thought I was some weird little person that, you know, would start the Manson show, like some weird scrappy little person, and then they realized, no. is this music? What is this? Yeah. But did you know who Peaches was when you saw that show?
Yes, of course, it came because of you.
Oh, you did? That's cute. Yeah, because I know a lot of people I met throughout the years, they're like, I didn't know who you were, but then I saw that show and I thought, oh, you, that was the real show.
So it was worth it to go through this.
Yeah, no, it was worth it for my development, for my understanding of how hostile fans can be.
What contexts are you interested in performing or playing, or are you interested in performing contexts that can be challenging, where unexpected things can happen, where you sort of step out of your comfort zone?
I feel like there are moments of that. Definitely, I project in control, so I'm safe. Mm-hmm. I'm safe. I feel like the context where I was the least in control was, and I'm not trying to drop names, this is just how I feel, when Yoko Ono asked me to recreate her cut piece. Mm-hmm. And I had to be on stage completely silent, and there was a pair of scissors in front of me, and people one by one could come up and cut pieces of my clothes. And that was terrifying, because I had never been silent on stage without any music, and also I didn't, anything could have happened, you know? People stole my shoes, I wanted to run after them, because that's not cutting, that's just stealing. But people cut my hair, people were like yelling at me, why aren't you talking to me? I have a question for you, you know, things like that. So, and it was a very sort of charged in terms of like, of course there was security there, like, should, you know, how much comfort or how far do you let the audience go? I was very lucky that nothing dangerous happened. But.
Performing your shows, you feel completely comfortable in having physical interaction with the people coming on stage, the people touching you, the people.
People don't really come on stage. I don't, you know, I go into the audience, yeah. But
I saw video footage of Fuck the Pain Away, which
was... Oh, yeah, but those are people invited.
Yeah.
You're more invited. But I have to say that I used to get a lot more perverted action when I would go out into the audience where people would try and, like, slip a hand into, you know, my hot pants, and I'd feel the hand coming, and I'd be like... you know, things like that, or like coming back on stage and having to give a consent speech or blah, 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 things like that. But on this tour, I feel like people are, it's been very cohesive, and I feel very lucky. I've gotten to moments where I'm lying on the back and doing like splits and spread eagles and stuff like that, and nobody's going like, yeah.
Hi.
Hi.
Thanks for the show last night. Could you talk a little bit about the other performers on stage, how
sure.
you found them, the musicians and dancers?
I would love to, yeah. So on stage there are four main performers. There's also everybody involved in sort of backstage and technical are and can be part of the show. So I have Federica Dauri, who's been with me probably for like 8 years on and off as a dancer, doing a lot of like spontaneous, hey, can you come on this tour, put on this vagina costume? Okay, yeah, yeah. Stuff like that. Her and herself is an incredible durational performance artist. She does beautiful work, very quiet, very long. We have Natasha Elson, last name.
Virgilio,
I didn't want to say it wrong. Natasha Virgilio, who's actually, this is my production manager, my partner, my technical director, like, I think. also like a sort of like creative consultant and super partner. Yes, my boyfriend. also known as Black Cracker, but Elson Glenn. And I did want to shout you out for a reason. It was in the context of... So Natasha Ellison has worked with Natasha many times on his own incredible projects, and I poached her. Sorry. but she's incredible. Just a beautiful, incredible dancer. Tiff Lamson, who is the drummer, I met in New Orleans 3 years ago when I did a production at a special place there, and she gathered together some incredible musicians, and yeah, she has incredible drumming skills. Blaheen Eckhart, I knew her as a guitarist. I knew she could shred. Not that Peach's music is shredding music, but I her skill is incredible. She's more into like black metal. She's also a contemporary dancer. So I thought that's such a great combination. As long as we have wireless equipment, you can do anything in terms of like, you know, playing guitar and also just bridging that sort of movement and, you know, guitar elements. So she was, to her, she's kind of like, she's the youngest one in the, you know, of the performers, and very, very, very smart. And it was really fun to develop this sort of character of hers, like pretending to try and take over the show in these little ways, but also to showcase her talent. Yeah, just want to showcase the talent. Ixa is also, she's an incredible performer onto herself. And when I wanted to have a sort of like a stage tech, somebody who comes in, you know, like moves the microphone around or make sure, I didn't want, you know, this like typical, this person comes on like, so Ixa always make sure they have like good heels on and the makeup's right, and then they will do their job. And Hillary was also, she's not a performer, but we have turned her into sort of like this kind of like excitable champion for the show, and also the halftime waving the flag for abortion. But she's doing a lot of really organizational work backstage, and making sure all the performers are, all their costumes are clean and fresh, and that I'm feeling good. And yeah, and also Elson. Every once in a while, I'll give away a secret. Like I'll pull Elson on stage, like they're. Maybe like a local tech or, oh, who knows, random, and then we have a little sort of eye-to-eye romance thing, see how close we can get. So it's really fun to make sure that all the people that are involved are also performatively feeling a part of the team, not like separated. Even Thomas, our stage manager, one night I thought someone randomly got on stage and there was Thomas in like a skin-colored like bodysuit with these huge sunglasses dancing around, and I was like, wow, that's my tour manager.
So also thanks for last night. And maybe a question that adds to this. So how does the creative process work to put all these things together? It's very theater-like, and you said you have this background anyway. But if I look at it with all the costumes and how it comes together, it's simple, but not simple at all, very conceptual. What's the process? Is it more you? Is it a team? How does it all come together? How does a huge penis like this come into existence?
I mean, a lot of things happen organically, believe it or not. Okay, now I get to tell my penis story. So I was in a club, and there was someone beside me, and they whispered in my ear, "Peaches, I have a big dick for you." And I was like, ready to be like, "Excuse me?" And I look over, and this person's like, no, I'm an artist. No, I have this company called Plastic Fantastic. and I make public sculptures, and I have this tube with a zipper, and I think if you put, I feel like if you put a fan on the end of it like we do, you could walk over people, like just out of nowhere. And it's funny because I had just written a song called Dick in the Air, so it's featured prominently in the music video that also features Margaret Cho. And it's in the show now. So something like that happened very organically. It wasn't like, I thought about Pink Floyd and their penises that they used to have. But this is in the tradition of a very rock rock idea, where there was like a, you know, I don't know if you know, I don't remember which I don't know, which Pink Floyd tour it was, but they had like this huge penis that comes out. So it's kind of like a nod to that. The large vaginas, is that maybe another thing you're interested in? Was originally one of my Australian dancers, Jess Daly, when she heard my album Rub, which was the album that she was one of the dancers for, she's like, I made these oversized vaginas, and I thought maybe we could dance in them. Because I would have thought, oh my God, no way, that's just too much. But it is such a delight and a pleasure for everybody. And these are the version two of them, so. Yeah, and then other ideas, they take a long time. And if you want, you know, you could talk to Ellison and maybe give him love for all the stress I had putting this show together. So sorry, it's a lot of like, like thinking that, oh, what if I put this song there and there? It's not gonna work, but of course, nobody's gonna notice but me. But I wanted to make sure that it had this feeling of past, so I recreated songs on the 505. I wanted to have a live archival feel, so I took costumes, real costumes that I'd learned that I've used throughout the 20 years, and also create new and forward-thinking costumes, and also nods to old ones. So, like, after they strip their, hot pant after hot pant, which are all like original hot pants that I wore, which I used to do, strip hot one to the other. Then I pick up, I don't know if you noticed, the coat that I'm wearing is made out of hot pants. So that was like a new concept. Let's make a, you know, things like that. Or the Operate Prolapse outfit where you can fit three performers in.
That is so brilliant, yes.
I guess the last one.
Yeah.
This is the last question.
Hello. Can you tell us a little bit more about the last song of your show?
Yes.
Because I think it's maybe it's a little bit confusing for some people.
Were you
completely
confused?
Different sound.
Were you confused?
No, not me, but...
I'm just asking.
But for example, yeah. I saw the first show of this tour in Stockholm, and my first thought was, oh, it's a thing for, like, ABBA.
Yeah, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Why not?
Is it an old song as well?
Oh, do you not know the song? Do you know the song?
The song, yeah, yeah.
Do you know this song?
No.
Ah, this is the thing. It's a song. It's a Celine Dion song.
Ah, okay.
It's called "It's All Coming Back to Me." It's written by Jim Steinman, who is actually my guilty pleasure of favorite songwriters. They wrote "Total Eclipse of the Heart," and they wrote all the Meatloaf songs from "Bad Outta Hell" and "But I Won't Do That," you know. And that's very, very dramatic storytelling. And this particular song I find so ridiculous because it's 7 minutes long. And it's it just goes on in these like repetitive ways. But I'm fascinated by it because it's also A, challenging to sing, B, challenging to get through because it's 7 minutes, and then also completely not in a traditional, if we can say traditional Peaches wheelhouse. But I have my own obsession with power ballads and also a new way of connecting with people, and I wanted to put it in, you know, literally as a joke to say, but it's all coming back to me, you know? And then going into the song, like actually going into singing it. And then, of course, Blaheen is not only a shredder, but an incredible pianist. And the concept was to make it longer as long as you can and stretch it out. And also just see, it's amazing the reaction. I did not expect the reaction of people to be like this. It becomes its own performance. Like this moment, there's no music and we could be waving for like 5 minutes, you know, just all these other contexts. And they also, I feel like it's a chance for the audience to see how connected I feel to people and how I can, you know, just not feel like I have to take the song so seriously, but also make it my own in a performance. And yeah.
It was beautiful, so beautiful.
And the performance continued on the streets. Uh-huh. People leaving the place, the venue, singing. Peaches, thank you very much.
Thank you. I enjoyed myself.
Thanks
thank you so much.
Thanks for being Peaches. Thanks for being here.
Thank you for being here. Yeah.